Welcome to the RFL of Unlicensed Podcast. We are back again. My name is Caleb, and of course, with always, we've got Tasos over here. Say hi, Tasos. Yay.
What's up? Hi, Tasos.
And today we are joined by Jorge, all the way from also RF Elements. So,
hello, everyone. Thank you for having me today again.
So, quick music intro jam, and then we'll get to it. All right, guys, so we are back again, 2023. So we've been a little slow on our podcast updating schedule yet. End of last year was kind of crazy. You know, we had Wispapalooza, which is always just chaos. Got back from that. We had Titan Fest, the holidays, and then now we're really just kind of want to wrap up, you know, what we saw last year, what we're looking forward to this year, and we're going to talk with Jorge. He's got some cool new stuff coming up, focusing on our Latin American market, so going to be a good time. So I guess as we get into it, Tasos, you want to give the good people out there their call to action?
Yeah, absolutely. Don't forget to like, listen, and subscribe to our channel right here on YouTube or anywhere you download your audio podcasts like Apple, Google, or Spotify.
Cool. All right, so I guess looking back, you know, last year, we don't want to spend too much time in memory lane, but, you know, it was a pretty active year in the old WISP market, a couple of things going on. I mean, you know, obviously still kind of working through the mass chaos from the COVID times. That seems to have pulled back, got a little bit towards a normal or whatever we want to consider normal anymore.
Definitely way more normal.
Yeah, definitely. So, but you know, we've seen a lot of like really cool potential things, you know, working our way through. Of course, you know, we had a number of podcasts last year about all the craziness and, you know, government funding, competition. I mean, we talked about CBRS stuff a lot. We talked about Toronto coming up a lot and what that's doing in the market. Let's see what else. Of course, 6GIG, you know, 6GIG is a big one. We want to throw some information out there this week, talk about 6GIG, where we are now, kind of what we're looking forward to on 6GIG. But you know, I guess from a summary perspective, man, like, you know, anything we want to really hit up in great detail here?
Yeah, I mean, definitely 6GIG. I think there's quite a bit to talk about that's getting kind of exciting here. You know, Cambium is now releasing their hardware. So like the 4600L, 4600 series radios are out in the market. So a lot of people are testing. The feedback looks pretty promising so far as speeds, reliability, and stuff like that. Even its ability to handle the noise, which is really exciting. You know, our horns, our current 5 GHz horns, actually quite a few of our antennas already work in the 6GIG range. Quite a few WISPs are already trying out our like symmetrical 30-degree horn. Our UltraDishes and UltraHorn are all performing really well in 6GIG. Clearly we have, you know, we will have brand new SKUs for 6 GHz. So the whole line of symmetrical and asymmetrical that's specifically made from, you know, the 6 to 7 or maybe 5.9 to 7.1. I'm not sure what that exact spec is going to be, but, that's going to be really cool. We've already seen prototypes and, you know, they're itty bitty. They're much smaller than the original ones, you know, because the wavelength is smaller. So the antennas get a little bit smaller. So that's kind of cool, but I'm really excited to, you know, what I'm seeing already in 6GIG, especially with our horns, and I think what we're going to see in the future.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, the testing we've seen in 6GIG with the 4600 stuff, like really noisy areas, like point to point links, you know, people are just killing it, especially using the ultra horn. You know, not a lot of noise in 6GIG yet, obviously, but we've had some people kind of generate their own, you know, in these test areas just to see what is it going to do, you know. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The results are having really cool. Starting to see some of the just insane seeds, what we're pulling on the access points and everything. So to put a little more color on it too. So, you know, the new products that we are releasing, so we're definitely releasing new horns for 6, you know, that's definitely coming. Those will be closer to more release info and data once the ASC gets a little bit closer. Right. So when is that? Was it hashtag soon?
Hashtag. Who knows, man?
Yeah. Hashtag who the hell knows, right? So
maybe later.
Yeah. Sometime later. So I don't know. What we're hearing now is probably going to be Q3. You know, into Q2, the FCC people get set up and ready to go and wait for the FCC to do their stuff. But I mean, again, this has been, you know, two quarters, three quarters away. Plus, we just add a quarter every quarter we go into. So will give us a lot more details as to what those new products use are all look like, specs and pricing and all that stuff a little bit further down the road. But we do want to point out, hey, y'all, this stuff's coming. We're getting a lot of questions. Now, again, like Tasos said, for the ones that are testing now, so we specifically went and tested several products that we knew that would work in this upper band to get some official specs. So the Symmetric 30 Horn, the UltraDishes, and the Ultra Horns, we have tested. They're good up to 60, 70, 75, which covers most of that outdoor range. Beyond that, you really don't want to really run it beyond that. The patterns fall apart. VSWR gets too high, so on and so forth. But for those three lines, we've updated the spec sheets as well. So if you don't remember, just look at the spec sheets. They're up to date. Those new ranges are shown in that spec sheet as well. So if you're testing with stuff, it is definitely available. And give it a shot. Let us know. Like, we'd love to hear the feedback and stuff, right? Things,
yeah.
Especially if, you know, folks start testing, like, the split sector functionality. Again, really see how this is doing for speed. We've got a lot of interest, people looking to use the UltraDish with the 4600C and our EPMP 2K adapter. You know, that already works with that, right? So same form factor as some of the other variants before. So what we're waiting for now is sort of some long distance results or running those really high SMRs, right? So if you're wanting to run this 1024 QAM, 4096 QAM leagues, you're definitely going to need a really high SNR. And one of the best ways to do that is with, you know, high quality 27 dBi dish and running with that TPA. And let us know, man. We're super excited to kind of see what those results are going to look like. So
yeah.
We got that. It looks like the 5 gig stuff's going to be coming just down the road before too much longer as well. We're excited to see what those results are going to be, especially in noisy areas. You know, there's tons of noise in 5 gig to play around with, and I'm really excited to see how well that AX platform works in those noisy 5 gig areas, especially can then do a like-for-like comparison against an existing system, you know, like a 3000 or a Prism or something like that. So, you know, it's not necessarily magic, but there's a lot of really cool stuff in the AX protocols that they're utilizing in here that should give us some really cool, crazy kind of performance for sure. So,
yeah. What do you see, Jorge, like in Latin America? I mean, do you have a 6 gig out there? I mean, I know there's a lot of Mimosa customers that they use Mimosa out there because it goes up to 6.4. I don't think it's exactly legal, right, or whatever, but what's the 6 gig spectrum? Is there any talks in Latin America for that stuff?
Yeah, there are actually Brazil was the first one already that they did the first outdoor test for the 6 gigahertz already. So in Brazil, it's definitely moving forward with Camion.
Yeah.
And on the rest of the countries, Mexico, for example, which is one of our biggest markets down there, it's definitely, they said that by the end of February, beginning of March, they should be already publishing the whole regulation of the 6 gig.
Nice.
But it's going to be the same. They follow the FCC, basically. So it's going to be, as you guys do in the US, they will do that in Mexico as well. So definitely that country is going into the 6 gig very hard. Also, Colombia will be the other player there that also, they have very advanced regulations. So any moment should be released. And the rest of the countries are quite smaller, but also picking up on this. Sure. Throughout last year was very promising. December ended up very well. With this 6 gigahertz, so we are expecting this quarter actually very big revelations, like approvals, finally testing all these things. So not that far behind, I would say.
That'd be interesting to see how that plays out. But we also, like I said, you know, 5 gig, right? So this AX stuff is coming in 5 gig as well. So that'll be exciting for everybody.
For sure, for sure. So, and that's kind of the way, you know, across the world globally, I think most countries now have opened up the indoor bands, you know, to cover the 6 gig range, you know, that came with the 6E part of the standards
6E,
and stuff.
Yeah.
So, you know, everyone's sort of done that in a lot of places internationally. You're going to be kind of following the lead as to what the US and the FCC does with AFC, right? Some aren't, of course, it's just kind of dependent. So look up the rules for your region. You know, some are going to have pretty heavy EIRP limitations. Some are going to have application limitations. Some will just follow in lockstep with us and implement very similar systems, which I'm sure will just be spin off of the existing systems, right? So if you've got a Qualcomm AFC or Federated or something, I'm sure they're going to be duplicating these for these regions as well, because most of the work's already done. So again, most of this coordination exists because it's mainly to just not interfere with the existing license links that are in this band. You know, in the U.S., for sure, there's a ton of these microwave links that are in that lower part of 6 gig, and a good number that are in the upper part of 6 gig. And this AFC is basically trying to, or will be, preventing the radios that we're using in our space for broadcasting and interfere with those license links, right? So, if what I've seen, the test results have been really positive. Like, you know, one of the big fears is it's going to block out whole giant areas where you're not going to use it. But from everything I've seen so far, it's really promising. Instead of, you know, it'll cut out a couple of slices here where you can't use, but then you've got the whole rest of the band to use. So at least here in the U.S., you know, we're talking 850 megahertz of spectrum that's opened up for outdoor use. So, you know, it's a tremendous amount of spectrum. Again, we're very excited. We've talked about this in the past, you know, a few times. Well, because we're pumped, and now the equipment is like, now the people are actually starting to test with stuff and see what it's starting to do. Now it's like, all right, time to get excited, guys. Let's see what things are going to do. So,
yeah, it'll be interesting to see what other hardware vendors do. I mean, obviously, you know, MU-MIMO already has their A6 platform. Haven't really heard much about that, and you know how well it's doing and who's really testing it. But even Tirana, right, it'd be interesting to see if Tirana goes the 6 gigahertz route, because right now it's just CBRS and 5 gig. They're kind of quiet on what you do on 6. I don't know if it was part of their original plan to have 6. Is it something that they're like, maybe, hey, we just have to do it now? I mean, it could take a year or two just to get FCC certification for the hardware and 6 gigs if they're just starting now. So it'd be interesting to see where that goes as well.
Yep, for sure. So we got that coming, of course, the AX, you know, there's the band part of it, the new tech part of it is coming, is really cool. What are some stuff we've been talking about?
I guess also just to add something, sure, on the 6 yeah. gig, definitely the most important thing that we follow as a company is that, like, you know, speak to people, teach them not to make the same mistakes that they did in 5 gig.
Yeah.
You know? So
tell me about
really,
it.
Good really point. Make sure that they deploy the right gear for what they need, okay, to avoid, of course, all the issues with noise and all these things in towers, all the, you know, all the negative stuff that we learned already from the 5 gig. We should not do it in 6. So part of our work is also to teach the people, speak to them also, be there, you know, as a manufacturer.
We definitely did a lot of that, obviously, in 5 gig, and that's why, you know, we made 5 gigahertz so successful. Yeah, we saved 5 gig from itself, you know, but
yeah,
I know in the early days, I mean, I saw some, I think it was like some MIMOSA testing, you know, with Omnis, and I'm just like, here we go again.
Yeah.
Right? And it's unfortunate that most of the technology that's coming out now for 6 gig, and, you know, I mean, this is just the way beamforming goes, is, you know, all built again on patch array antennas, right, which have all these side lobes. And although, you know, people like to say that they use the side lobes for beamforming, but that's not really how it works. You know, the side lobes that are created are really creating noise and dirtying things up. So yeah, that's how they kind of use the beams to kind of focus and shoot some over here, shoot some over there. But you got to remember, they like to show in their spec sheets or in their and the representations of how it works, this nice little perfectly elliptical node going here or here. And they don't show all the side lobes that are around that, you know, making all that noise. So, you know, horns will be fantastic with this, you know, new stuff. You know, beamforming doesn't always have to just happen with a patch array antenna. Hopefully WISPs will see that early and not, like you said, not destroy the spectrum, especially with the fact that, you know, they're starting out, everybody wants to run 160 megahertz channels, you know,
yeah.
That's already, I'm dying a little bit inside every time I hear somebody want to do that, you know, that's the thing. I was reading some blog that somebody wrote. Was Matt Larson, right? He wrote a really cool blog. And one of the things he was talking about, like, the first step is like, stop chasing the hype, right? This fucking, you know, everybody's racing for this gig to the home kind of a thing. And yeah, I mean, some people need it, but that's not what everybody needs. What we need is good, reliable, you know, sustainable and, you know, stable internet is what people need. Of course, speed is part of it, right? You know, we can't be selling 1 and 2 5-meg packages anymore.
Right.
But, you know, you're selling 25, 50, 100-meg packages. I mean, that's like 90%+ of the people. That's more than sufficient for. You know, if you looked at the the pre-sim report, you see that the average house or the average person still utilizes like 7 megs. That's it, you know, and we're selling them gig plans and stuff like that. So, you know, if we use Spectrum, you know, properly, then it'll be around for a long time to use. And I mean, 5 gig is not dead. I mean, it's still very, you know, feasible to utilize it. Like I said, I'm excited for the Cambium 4500 AP stuff, 4500 series, basically the 5 gigahertz AX stuff. I really can't wait to see that stuff come out and see what we can still do in 5 gig, because, you know, the AX protocol has that, you know, spectrum piercing or something where, like, you know, it just has like little 5 megahertz slots that go across the entire spectrum to dance around noise. And that's going to be really cool stuff to see how that works.
Yeah, it's going to be really adaptive, and I think we're going to see a rejuvenation. That's the fancy $5 word I was looking for right there. Rejuvenation of the band, you know, and just being able to pull a lot more speed and capacity versus what we were before. So, and then in 6, you know, I mean, I think we're going to see a ton of usable 80 megahertz channels, I think, is where folks are going to settle in on, you know. So, yeah, 80 is real sexy, 160, 320, you know, okay, that's a little crazy, right? But, you know, there's enough spectrum, and if we use it smartly and don't just shoot ourselves in the foot, then we've got a wide number of 80 meg channels that we can very easily sell, you know, 100 meg plans on and have good capacity, have good ROI, and like all these, you know, things you need to be successful in this. So it's going to be real fun times. Looking forward to it.
Yeah. I mean, honestly, I mean, we can go beyond 100 meg on an 80 megahertz channel, right?
Yeah,
so,
sure.
I mean, at 1024 QAM, that's 800 meg, right? Of basic on an 80 megahertz channel that you get, right? So you can easily sell 200, even 300 meg packages on an 80 meg channel. Obviously, how many is another story, but with multi-user MIMO and stuff like that, it really becomes a possibility in both 5 and 6 gig. And we even have to start talking about, you know, some of the hardware like the Cambium, I think it's the 450V, that will basically do like almost carrier aggregation, right? You'll be able to do 5 and 6 gigahertz at the same time. So if you, that's the best way to run 160 megahertz channels, like 80 meg and 5 gig and 80 meg and 6 gig, you know, none of this, all your eggs in one spectrum basket.
Yeah, those are going to be some wild times. So yeah, a lot of really cool stuff to look forward to for sure. So getting lots of funding opportunities, kind of looking outside just band stuff. I'm kind of excited to see, you know, a lot of what WISP has been doing lately, just trying to get people on a more sort of unified footing. I mean, that's always been the goal, right? And it grows and progresses. I think what I've seen, we've seen real recently is a lot more push and focus sort of on the state level advocacy and grouping and stuff. So, like, they just did this recent show here in Milwaukee that Tasos was at, so...
Very good show.
Yeah, because Milwaukee in January, excellent timing, guys. So,
but it was worth it. It really wasn't that cold. I mean, honestly, it's like in below zero now, right? So
yeah,
I mean, it was in the 30s when I was there. So it was perfect. It was perfect weather.
But you know, that's where a lot of these like battles are really going to be won and fought. You know, because it's like, you know, there's some doom and gloom about a lot of the funding and competition and stuff like that. But I mean, realistically, we've beat on this so many times in the past is, you know, if you get to understand what your state level folks, your county, even your local municipality level folks are doing, you're going to find that they're going to be a lot more willing to work with a local operator that understands the area, understands their constituency. My constituency. Oh,
yeah.
Such a good movie. But anyways, and, you know, is going to be willing to work with you and get past a lot of those pain points than dealing with just some, you know, multinational conglomerate juggernaut for sure. So,
yeah. And that's where, I mean, a lot of it is flowing. And actually, that was some of the stuff. But again, this, you know, like chasing the gig thing, I think is really from the federal level, all that federal money. But now all that, again, that federal money is going down to the state level to dole it out. It's actually sounding like, you know, those gig to the home thing is really not what the states want, right? Or at least, you know, the local players, you know, the local municipalities, you know, are able to get around that kind of thing and say, look, we just need to deliver good internet. We need to deliver it now. We need to deliver it to everybody. So the state funded money is really where you want to go, because that's where you're able to just do what's best and you know, do it your way rather than, you know, the way some bureaucrats in the federal government have told you it has to be. You know, they probably have people clicking the mouse for them. You know, they don't even know how to use the internet. But anyway, yeah, it's the state level stuff that's really exciting. And I think that's where we're really going to make a difference to kind of bridge this digital divide that everybody keeps talking about, you know?
Yeah. So there'll be a lot more conversation on that at WISP America, which is like it's a month
next
from
month.
Now, basically. So
yeah.
Time
That's
keeps
crazy.
On ticking, baby. But yeah, so that'll be in Louisville, Kentucky. Of course, we'll be there full force doing our thing for sure. So it'll be, it was like, did we just do a show? I'm like, oh, no, wait, that was 5 months
I'm
ago.
I'm telling
so.
You, it's flown so fast. How about you, Jorge? Is the year just like, since last year, just boom, it's gone.
Yeah.
And, you know, it seems like almost the end of the year is going to come again soon, you know?
It's very quick. Definitely, time is flowing like really fast. Definitely.
Yes. Do you guys see any? Do you guys see any? Like, is there any government funding in Latin America as well? Is there any money flowing into WISPs or into internet at all from the, you know, the government level?
Not really. Not really. The way they operate there is different. It's mostly just private companies putting money into some of the selected operators in different countries. But the government in that part is just create their own stuff. They don't really fund like operators in the middle of nowhere or in rural areas. So no funding.
I'm sorry, guys. We've done a terrible job introducing Jorge here. So I apologize for that. Fans, because I'm like,
it's never too late.
Yeah, it's Jorge, the guy I've worked with for a couple years now. Late. Everyone knows him too. So Jorge handles, he's one of our product managers. He handles a lot of the social media stuff. So you'll see him in all of our Latin American videos. You know, he's the all the YouTube stuff and everything. You know, he's the one doing the main presenting, the webinars and stuff like that. Handles a lot of the social media, but is also does a lot of the account management and service and stuff. I mean, for Latin America in general. So, and anywhere where they speak Spanish. Very handy. Makes so, Jorge, if you want to give us a little bit of your background, you know, how long have you been here? Kind of, you know, what's your background in the space and stuff?
Yeah.
We're going to talk about kind of what you've got coming up in relation to podcast stuff and things like that.
Yeah, definitely. Well, I am in this wireless thing for a little bit over a decade now. I started with this, basically, but my first router was like this WRT54. The Linksys that everybody knows which one it is.
Yeah.
And then I used basically all the technologies, TP-Link, then UBNT, and etc. I used to have run a WISP in my country for more than a decade there until I basically joined RF Elements, and then I just left that to somebody else. So I had plenty of experience in device configurations, installing devices in towers, because we used to do our own towers and we install our own devices. So I climbed towers many times as well.
What was that like? I mean, because for people who don't know, I mean, his home country is Cuba, right?
Yeah.
So it's pretty interesting there.
Yeah. Yeah. It was really a boom after 2010. I don't know how, but devices just started entering the country in huge amounts. So we have all the UBNT, all the MicroTik lines were really there. Actually, MicroTik found out about that and they decided to do a MU-MIMO in Havana in 2016, which is where I met one of the salesperson of RF Elements. So we started there. Basically, was our own private thing. I remember the first network I had was computer to computer, you know, one LAN cable, 50 meters across the neighborhood. Everything started like that. At the end of the day, we had a tower with dozens of APs there. So we had all the suites of devices you can imagine there. And we really test them to the limit because since we didn't have more devices to keep growing, we started doing like more optimization of the network we had. And that's how we learned all the MicroTik, all the, you know, router OS, how to really go deep into the network and make it more stable with what we had. So at the end of the day, we were offering packages that were almost 20 megs.
Wow.
Per customer. Yeah. Yeah. Everybody was living fairly close, I would say no more than 3 kilometers.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, and we also did install a few horns as well that they're actually working there.
Yeah.
Now it's very good. Yeah. So, just to follow up, then basically I finished my university in 2018, and then I got the opportunity to come to work with RF Elements. I met RF Elements in 2015. It was the first time online, in the online presence. And then I started to really interact with what you were doing, because we were facing the same issues. You know, this amount of devices deployed, we were having noise issues all the time, but we didn't know what it was. So watching the webinars that Tasos was doing, I learned that, you know, hey, we were facing that, you know. And then I slowly started investing more time into RF Elements. I got to know some of the people online. I started to work in the early stages of the RF Elements Spanish group. Mm-hmm. At that point, it was newborn, let's call it this way. And then I had the opportunity to come here to Slovakia, where I am now. So, which is very cold, by the way.
Yeah, after buying many jackets and sweaters.
Yeah, oh boy, you have no idea. I look like an alpinist in the mountain with the amount
like
of layers.
Like you're climbing Everest in this like
team.
Fall.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like, wait, there's no palm trees here. Where are the palm
yeah,
trees?
I miss the palm trees, definitely.
Yeah, so tell us about your podcast. I mean, how do you see it developing there for Latin America?
Yeah, well, first let's say that there's going to be a podcast.
Yes.
So we haven't actually gotten that part yet. So we're talking internally, and, you know, Tasos and I have been doing this for a little while now, but just due to the nature that we're both based in the States, you know, and this is where our entire experience has been, you know, it's easy for us to be sort of, you know, U.S.-centric, right? Just a nature of, you know, where we are, and a lot of, like, the technical and RF side doesn't really change at all, obviously, right? But, you know, a lot of times when you start dealing with funding and regulations and stuff like that, you know, a lot of this stuff doesn't necessarily apply to the rest of the globe. So we talked about it, and we decided we'd like to open up the podcast for Latin American regions. And, you know, a native Spanish speaker obviously helps with that tremendously. So we're going to be launching another version of the podcast, or an offshoot. Well, we're at the mechanics here very soon, so...
Yeah, we're working on it.
We'll make those details clear when we get details,
yeah.
Right?
But,
so, and basically, it's going to be Jorge, just, kind of tell us what you're thinking so far, how you're going to attack it, how you're going to approach and grow it up.
Well, first of all, we have a massive crowd in Latin America. There's thousands of followers there. And we're going to start basically interviewing people as well, and then also inviting them to share not only what they have been doing with RF Elements, but also their experience in a wireless market, because there are many of them that easily can be or have been working for over the 2 decades. So I want that knowledge also to be transmitted to the rest of the crowd, because as we know, many people there are really still lacking, you know, a little bit more of education. So this is another mean that RF Elements will use basically to get to those people. You know, we understand that people are really overloaded with the online webinars and the things we used to do, which were very successful the last 2 years. So now we are going to go also on this format and prepare the content in a different way. Like, the idea behind that is basically the training of people and teaching them, you know, the right how to do deployments based not only from our point of view, but also from their colleagues in the field, you know, from people who are there also installing the same devices they're using. Maybe they are living in the same country, so they will familiarize quickly with them. So we have a bunch of people waiting to participate. So we're going to definitely set up all the details, and I guess we'll start very soon with this episode as well. So.
Real
Stay
soon,
tuned. Right?
Yeah, real soon. Not us hashtag sayings there.
Yeah, real soon. So
yeah, the interview format, I think we found it, and our listeners found it to be extremely helpful. I mean, we're going to be doing a lot more of this year, as we've kind of got this thing cranked back up on our side. We're just getting a lot of interviews and stuff scheduled out. So hey, if you want to be a part of the current version as is now, or you want to be interested in talking to Jorge for his version of the podcast, please. Reach out to us. I mean, we can be found everywhere.
Any platform.
Yeah, any platform.
Basically. Any platform, social media, we are there, paying close attention to what's going on.
Yep, so RF Elements English, RF Elements Espanol.
Espanol,
Yeah, there's a ton of folks there. So, yeah. I mean, you can also find us, I mean, Tasos, and I, you know, super easy to find, so... Very cool. I'm looking forward to that. I think it's going to be a great experience for everyone, and we'll see where it goes from there, so...
I will definitely put the cherry on top of the cake here to basically say a quick message to our perhaps viewers in Spanish to the in this podcast, right? So I open parentheses now. Amigos, bueno, todas las personas que nos están escuchando por acá en este podcast en inglés, por favor estén atentos. Vamos a estar lanzando un podcast en idioma español. Si están interesados en contar su historia, su experiencia en el terreno, va a ser muy valioso para los demás amigos que están también en la misma línea, ¿no?, de esta de telecomunicación. Entonces, por favor, contáctenos si desean participar. Muchísimas gracias.
Awesome.
Basically, it's an invitation letter. Let's call it this way. Yeah. So,
very cool. Well, that's all I've got right now. Toss us anything else you really want to get into now. Like I said, we've got a lot coming up this year in the podcast, a lot of interviews, a lot of really cool stuff. So, looking forward to it.
Yeah, I mean, basically just WISP America, right? So looking forward to that coming up here soon. Hopefully we see a lot of you out there. Like Caleb said, you know, we're building our list of people to be on the show. So, I mean, if you're in Kentucky for WISP America, stop by our booth. If you want to be on the show, let us know. We'd love to have you on.
All right. Anyone else that won't be there, where can they find us, Tasos?
They can find us everywhere on social media, Facebook, Instagram. They can find information and contact information on our website, rfelements.com. You can go on our forum, rfelab.com, or in our Facebook groups like RF Elements English, Espanol, and RF Elements Proper.
All right. Well, good to be back, and I guess we'll be talking to everyone here again real soon. So until then, y'all be good.
See you next time.
Thank you, everyone. Bye. Thank you. Take care.
Ciao. Bye. Ciao, everybody. Ciao. Bye. Adios.
Adios, amigos.
Bye.